Hi, I'm Hollywood. Welcome to my show, Behind the Mask. In life, we wear many masks, our own image editors. There's projection and perception. What happens when we put the mask on, and what happens when we take them off? Let's peel the layers and find out. Come take a journey with me behind the mask as I interview some of the most interesting and diverse people in the world of entertainment, art, music, charities, fashion, and more. Are you ready? My special guest is a man so multifaceted, his life reads like a James Bond movie. He is a world-renowned private investigator, creator, author, producer, actor. Please welcome Logan Clark. Hi, Logan. How are you?
I'm doing great. How about you?
Good. It's been a long time. Such long a pleasure time. To see you.
Yeah, it has been.
Yeah. Well, welcome. Thank you for coming to Behind the Mask.
You're welcome.
So you have such an eclectic life. And, I mean, do you think you could do any more?
I hope not. God, I hope not.
I mean, private investigations, right? You've written several books and the entertainment business. Now, for people that don't know, you're one of the heads founders of the International Human Trafficking Task Force, and you specialize in human trafficking and parental child kidnapping. You want to share a little bit about that with us?
Well, it's two of the main things that the agency specializes in. The human trafficking, I have been involved with fighting for probably 35 years, 40 years. When I used to come back to the States and tell people that it's happening all over the world and it's coming here in the United States, everybody thought I was like the boy who cried wolf. You know, right? Nobody believed me. They said, oh, that only happens in foreign countries. Well, it's all over the United States. Yeah.
I want to ask you about the private investigations. What got you into the investigation business? What inspired you to become a private investigator?
I was a newspaper reporter when I was 18, 17 and a half years old, actually. I was one of the youngest columnists in the United States, in Hawaii. And I had my own column called The Young Believers, and I would do all kinds of stuff. And I wanted to be an investigative reporter, and I saw an ad in the paper for a detective school. And I thought, well, that would make me a better reporter. So to learn investigation. So I went to the school after 6 months, graduated top of the class, and then they evidently recommended me without my knowing to a detective agency. They called me in and they said, we would like you to go undercover. And I just turned 18. And they said, we'd like you to go undercover in Chrysler Motor Corporation. And I went, wow. I mean, 18 years old, and you're like, this is Mod Squad for real, or 21 Jump Street for real. And I jumped at it. They said, we'll give you a phony criminal background and everything else and put you in there. And you'll be there for 7 months. I said, let's do it. And I fell in love with it so much. It was such a rush that I gave up the newspaper column and decided to become a private detective. And I had been connected to the entertainment world for, you know, since I was young because my family was in it. And you always have to have a side job. So even later when I wanted to become an actor, I kept my private eye thing so that I could do that rather than be a bartender or a construction worker or whatever. I'd go do private detective work and then I would go do some acting work.
Pretty fascinating life there, very full of excitement on both arenas. Now you were trained by two legendary PIs. One of them was Hal Lipset and the other one, Walter Big Z Zawan. Sir, I cannot pronounce that.
Well, that's why he's called the Big Z.
The Big Z.
Yeah, because no one could pronounce his name.
And Hal was the guy that was attributed as being the PI that put the mic in the olive.
Yeah, in the martini.
In the martini.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he put it. And they used that in the James Bond movie. But he's actually the one who
invented it.
Yeah, we used to always say that his private eye license, say you all have numbers on your private eye license, and we always said Hal Lipset had 001. The first private detective. He was great.
What was it like being trained by them?
It was great. I was a great, rather than, I had to do all the stuff that normal PIs do. Do the surveillance, domestic husbands and wives, serve subpoenas and stuff like that. But because of who they were, they took on real wild cases. So after a year or two of, you know, getting myself trained and stuff, then I got to get into the really good stuff. And because I had done that undercover case, I was really fortunate. And I did really well at it. So most private eyes spend most of their lives doing domestic and doing what they call AOE, COE, guys that pretend to be hurt from work and they're out playing basketball and football, and yet they're being paid, you know, for disability.
Yeah.
And all private eyes want to get into the stuff that we're into now, but very few do. It's just a big leap.
What was your first biggest case like?
I think rescuing a kidnapped child was a real experience, a real different experience. Parental kidnapping in the old days when I started, in the 70s, was not against the law. There were no laws. Yeah. And so one parent would steal the child from another parent and take off to another state. And since there were no laws, we would have to go and literally kidnap the child back with the mother or the father, whoever we represented, was in a van. And then we would get them into the van, and they'd be there with their mom.
It was like an ongoing war with no regulations.
Yeah, I rescued one little girl and her brother three times.
When you finally retrieve the child and you get it back with its right parent, what is the effect this has on the child? I mean,
tremendous.
There seemed to be a tug of war going on, and the child seems to be being dragged around through this.
Yeah, there's a lot of issues. They wind up in therapy for years. It destroys the entire family function, and a child, you know, growing up to love your mom and your dad. Divorce is one thing. Divorce is rough enough to go through for any child, and 50% of all the marriages end in divorce.
Do the children realize they're being kidnapped?
Some do, some don't. Most of them don't realize it at first. They don't realize until they're so far away. They keep asking for dad, or they keep asking for mom, and they realize that. But the parent makes up all kinds of excuses, you know, reasons why it happened. But the kids get really messed up, and I still call them. I call the parents and ask them how the kids are doing, and I help them with development and with problems that come up. We get counselors for them. It just really messes them up.
Are the children fearful of the other parent that kidnapped them?
They're fearful of everybody. Yeah, mm-hmm. They're fearful of it. It just destroys the entire family foundation. They don't know who to trust anymore. They imagine being afraid of one of your parents because your other parent tells you you're supposed to be. And I mean, it's sick. It's absolutely sick. And it goes on endlessly. And it could be stopped. That's what makes me so damn mad. I could bring hundreds of children home.
Yeah. So you've been doing a lot of interviews on parental kidnapping. Mm-hmm. What is the point that you're trying to get across?
Well, the laws, I've been doing it so long. There are laws now. It is a federal crime for any parent to take their child and hide it from the other parent, kidnap it, leave the state, leave the country, whatever. There are strong laws. But the police and the district attorneys do not follow it. They're using what I call selective prosecution. They're avoiding taking any action, even though there's strong laws against it that can put people in jail and for a long time. They refuse to do anything, most of them. And I am insistent on the district attorneys and the police. There's 200,000 parental kidnappings every year in the United States that are reported. That's official. This is according to the Department of Justice. There are unreported 225,000 parental kidnappings. So you're talking about just under 500,000 kids kidnapped by one parent or another in this country every year. It destroys the family, destroys the kid. They're told, they're given new names, their hair is dyed, they lie, they...
No medical.
No medical. If they're on medication, a lot of times they go off the medication because we can track the medication when they fill it at any pharmacy in the United States. So it really destroys the entire family. And that family, then the uncles, the cousins, the brothers, the sisters, it just goes out. If you look at that 500,000 and multiply all the relatives of that, you're talking about millions of people in the United States. And it's got to stop. And what I do is I get the news. I will literally get the news, go to them, show them all the laws, and we will walk into the chief of police office with the 6 o'clock news behind me. And all of a sudden, they wake up and they go, oh yeah, we're gonna. And sometimes they do. I came back from Texas and we got the news and everything, and a new DA got elected in Austin, Jane Duty, and Roger Harris, her chief investigator, and she considered it a crime. And they asked me to come to Texas and teach them how to solve these cases. And I went and worked with them for 6 months. And we got these kids back from Mexico. And Roger literally wants to do it for the rest of his life. He said, I've found a new calling. He said, I've been doing, you know, this cop work for 20 years. He said, I've never felt such a rush, so accomplished, getting kids back.
Well, you're doing a great thing. Does this mean you'll be retiring soon since someone else is taking over?
Yeah.
I know you've been talking about that for a while.
Yeah, I've been trying to retire for 3 years. I always joke, I feel like Al Pacino in The Godfather. You know, every time I get out, they pull me back in. I get a call from somebody. I get a lot of work from other detectives because they'll come across cases and it involves kidnapping or murder or one of their detectives gets killed. And they don't want to touch the case and they go call Logan Clark because I'll take them. I'll take the crazy, the insane cases that other detectives, they just want to go do their domestic stuff.
Now that's something I want to ask you. I mean, you go on a lot of talk shows. You're mm-hmm. pretty. You have a lot of exposure, not just in this industry, but in the other industries that you're in. Are you ever concerned that people are watching you or will find you or put two and two
anymore.
Together?
Not anymore. But I did. There was a point. The first parts of my career, the first many years, I specialized in undercover. And when I was 18 years old, they put me undercover at Chrysler Motor Corporation mm-hmm. for a huge embezzlement thing. And I loved it. I loved the thrill. I loved the excitement. It was just a rush. And so I continued doing that. But as the years went on and I got better known, I knew one day when I needed to quit undercover work. I was undercover in a biker bar, in a Hell's Angels bar in San Pedro. I was standing at the bar drinking a beer, and it's all bikers, just all biker mamas and everything, and the bartenders are, and I'm watching the television and just drinking a beer, and I'm just trying to, you know, I had a bike outside and everything else, and I'm standing there and I looked up at the television set and I saw an episode of Simon and Simon and I immediately, you know, started to panic, and I realized what was going to happen. And so I started saying to the girl behind the bar, I said, the game's on, you know, switch it. And so the girl went immediately and started switching the channels away from that. And she goes, what? And I didn't even know what game. And then I'm trying to figure out what is it, baseball season? Is it basketball? I'm not that big into sports. I'm just going, the game, you know, change. And then she chants, I think it's on
kinda
that
like
channel.
Kind of like
the plane. Yeah, the plane, yeah. And I knew right then that this is the end of your undercover, Logan.
Well, that's why the BBC spent about 4 years researching all the top private investigators around the world, and you were named on this book one of the top 5 investigators in the world.
That was very nice. Yes, yeah. that was a great.
It's on A&E every year.
Yeah, they did
a
1 hour.
BBC, yeah.
Yeah, they should pick the 5. They researched it for 4 years, and then they picked the top, what they consider, what the BBC considered the top 5 in the world, in Europe and here. And then they did, after the book was written, then they did a 1 hour documentary on each of the 5 of us.
And if any of you have not read this book, it's called Watching the Detectives by Graham Noun. And Logan Clark is one of the 5 in here. So.
And over in the back, yeah. And there's pictures.
And there's pictures in the back.
That's Pinkerton, that's Burns, that's me, and that's J.J. Arms. J.J. Arms has no hands. His hands were blown off, and he has the claw, those 2 claws. And he's got a derringer that comes out of his sleeve.
Now, was that from being caught with something?
In childhood. Oh. His hands were blown off playing with
you have a saying about being a private detective. It's like acting take one.
The only difference between acting and what I do as a private detective is that in my business there's no take two. You screw up, you die.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Logan. That's such a, I mean, what you do is amazing, and I hope that they do listen to you and make some changes with the child kidnapping and the human trafficking, and I hope you continue doing it. I'd love to see you enjoy your life, but you are the best at what you do, and the world really, really needs you.
Well, now I want to make movies about it.
James Bond. We'll be right back. Joining us now is Matt Cinquanta, also a private investigator, a former pro football player who became an actor to overcome stage fright. He is also a producer along with Logan in the upcoming film 24 Hours and stars in it alongside Tom Sizemore and Michael Paré. Welcome, Matt.
Thank you.
How are you?
Very well, thank you.
Good. So this is a great film. Tom Sizemore, Michael Paré, and you're starring in it as well.
Yeah.
Tell us a little about the film. What is it about?
It's exciting. Well, we can't say much about it because we're still casting one more major player in the film. But
can you give us a premise?
I say it's a race against time thriller in the vein of Die Hard, I say, is a good way to describe it.
Now, what makes you guys choose the films that you choose to produce?
In reviewing the screenplays,
yeah.
We get a round table with the fellow producers and we just kind of go over what's exciting about different scripts and then narrow it down to a choice few and then pick one.
Is that action adventure? Is that something that appeals to you, obviously?
Definitely.
Yeah.
And it's what's commercial. There are certain things at certain times that are commercial, like the zombies and, you know, the different kinds of movies. But action adventure seems to always... You know,
always, yeah.
It'll always sell.
Mm-hmm. And you have a great cast, I hear.
Strong cast.
A lot of great actors in it. And yeah. When is it coming out?
It's undetermined at this time, but I'd say probably by August, you know. I'd say
yeah,
July.
End of the summer.
Yeah, end of the summer.
So we know you had an acting background, Logan, and you got into acting to overcome stage fright. Where did
I did. Yeah.
Tell, what was that about?
It's pretty much the biggest story of my life because it was such a life-defining, life-limiting problem to have. In the sixth grade, I hyperventilated in front of my class.
Oh.
I was up in front, like holding up the paper to do a speech. And
oh,
I couldn't talk, and it was like that. I mean, it got so bad that the teacher had to stop me and have me sit down. And so from that moment forward, I never read aloud from a book. I didn't raise my hand in class. I didn't talk. I mean, I wouldn't do it. Junior high school, college. I was a college football player and a decent one. So there was a lot of attention on me. So when I was supposed to do a report or something, people noticed when I wasn't doing it. Finally, I got tired of it. You know, I said I need to just conquer this demon.
What was the defining moment?
I came to LA from Denver, where I grew up, and I found the scariest acting class I could find, and one where they set you up on a hard stool in front of the class of 20. So with sweat rings down to the belt line on each side, I sat up there and with a split screen behind me so everybody could see, you know, close up of my face as I sweated it out. And it was awesome. It was the scariest thing I ever did. And it was the best thing I ever did because I turned a corner in life. I ended up having fun and being decent at it. And then 6 months later, I had an agent, which was crazy. And I was going on auditions and stuff. And then if I had never done that, the experiences that I've had, the people I've met now, new friends and new business acquaintances that I have now, I would have never had. So I mean,
it's funny, you were scared of acting, but you're a private investigator as well.
Yeah.
So,
one that pales in comparison to this guy.
I wonder, have you ever been afraid being up there acting, Logan?
No, I was pretty much the exact opposite.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was always, I'm pretty outgoing.
Yeah, this is a guy who's on TV while, you know, he's getting a murder confession. So what are some Logan, what you've worked with some great celebrities, from Brad Pitt to Pierce Brosnan. What are some of your favorite moments working with certain people on certain sets?
Wow. Man, yeah, gotcha. I worked with Susan Sarandon, Larry Hagman.
Oh gosh, what was Larry Hagman like? Tell us about that.
Larry was one of the coolest guys in the world. He was funny. He had a leather bag that we did Checkered Flag or Crash with Susan Sarandon and him and me and Alan Bent and Parnelli Jones. Anyway, he had a leather bag and he had everything in the world in that leather bag. He'd have a bottle of wine in there. He had a deck of cards. It became a joke on the set that if anything that you needed, you know, does anybody have a pair of scissors? Ask Larry. And I swear Larry would reach into this leather bag and pull out a pair of scissors.
I would have loved that. I'm kind of like the one that does that amongst my friends there. I'm like the go-to bag. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have any favorite celebrities you've worked with that you memorable moments?
That I've worked with? I stood in for Tom Sizemore, ironically enough. on another film 3 years ago, and that's where he and I met. So for a month, I was on the set with Tom.
What is it like working with him? He's an amazing actor.
He's a high-energy, intense guy, and he's fun, too.
Is he like that in real life?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fabulous.
Really, yeah, really good guy. Yeah. And Michael Paré was great. And I had never met him until this recent film. But yeah, Tom was excellent. But my experience is growing, so I don't have quite the, you know, the experience of being exposed to that kind of talent and the bigger names, you know, as much as this fellow here. But I mean, we are, you know, as time goes on, there's going to be many more opportunities for that. You know, the Pacinos and De Niros would be great. Morgan Freeman, I think we might work with him sometime in the near future, which is cool.
I hear you two are working, as soon as you wrap this one up, where you're done with the post and everything and the filming, you're on to another project already.
Yeah.
So, any... Mm-hmm.
Well, we're pretty sure we've got one script that we want to do. We're going through the budget now and kind of narrow it down. But there's other scripts. And you have to, when you pick a movie script, you can't just, you know, pick any script. You've got to look at it and go, okay, can we do this within the budget? So it's, we haven't made a firm decision. But we're thinking about Morgan Freeman and, was it?
Danny Glover and Christian Slater.
And Christian Slater, yeah.
Nice.
And
yeah,
that's kind of the guys we're going to go after, I think, mm-hmm, for the next one.
So from movie star James Bond to real life James Bond, Pierce Brosnan is interested in doing a miniseries on the story of your life.
Yeah, I didn't put that connection together, but yeah, that's pretty cool.
When are you guys planning on doing this, and what's it going to be?
It's been in development for 3 years now. It just depends on getting all the right pieces together. Pierce wanted to do, we're friends, we know each other from Dubai, and then became friends over here, and he wanted to do a movie about me and play me in a movie. And when we sat down with directors, we talked about it and everything, and I started getting into the stories like we've been doing here. And there were so many stories. My partner and I have about 18,000 files, closed cases in a warehouse. And there were just so many stories I started telling that the directors and Pierce and everybody said, this has got to be a TV series instead of just one movie. And so Pierce didn't want to play me on a television series. And if you do a series, I got to be like around 35 years old.
So who's going to play you?
We don't know.
Who would you want to play you?
Colin Farrell. He would be perfect.
He would.
But I don't think, you know, we can't get him. He's too big of a movie star, even though a lot of movie stars are movies.
Colin, you need to play Logan Clark. Yeah.
He could do
it. Listen to him. Lifetime.
Yeah, listen to her, Colin.
Yeah. Edward James almost wants to. Josh Hartnett said he wanted to play me in the series, but we're still putting the key people together. Pierce Brosnan is going to be the executive producer, mm-hmm, and he'll have a reoccurring cameo role. He's still going to be a movie star and make movies, but he will pop in and out of this. Mm-hmm. Like if you know, Kevin Spacey, you look at the television nowadays, and movie stars will do television shows, mm-hmm, because that's where some of the greatest stories are, some of the greatest scripts. Our show won't be... I think it'll be called Global Pursuit, but it's too edgy and it pushes the envelopes too much to be network, I think. I think we have to do it, you know, HBO or Showtime or something like that.
With your life, you would.
Yeah, and we were going to do it with Sony, and they tried to develop it for a couple of years and haven't been able to, and I pulled away from that, and now we're going to go talk to some of the other studios.
So you're also very well connected with Manny Pacquiao, and you were in the Philippines not too long ago, before the typhoon hit. You were planning on working on a film with him, but you also work with him on another capacity in the human trafficking business.
Yeah, Manny Pacquiao is a wonderful guy, just a great guy. And I was with him in October, and just before the big typhoon in the Philippines. And we're going to have him connected with us in a movie. But we made him the director of the International Human Trafficking Task Force for the Philippines. He's a second-term congressman. He won by a landslide. And one of his main agendas or platforms as a congressman is to stop human trafficking, which is huge in the Philippines and Southeast Asia. So we're working on that together. And then this film, we have a film called In the Eye of the Storm, which is a pretty large movie. Matt will be involved in it, is involved in it also, but we're gonna do two or three films before we get to that, before we get into a $5-6 million film.
And what is The Eye of the Storm about?
It's about a movie company that goes to the Philippines and shooting on location, and the studio doesn't really care that much about, you know, the director and the movie. They just kind of go over, they got a 3-picture deal with him, and he's finishing his last of the movies, and the lead actress is like a Jane Fonda type, real mouthy and political, and she gets kidnapped for real. And it's the whole story of the political, the studio is now getting $1 million a day publicity because she's been kidnapped, and they're in no hurry to get to rescue her, and because it keeps the publicity going. So we were over there in development with Manny and working on it, and then the typhoon hit, and it just stopped. 9,000 people killed, and we just backed out immediately. I lived there for 10 years. I speak the language, and we just couldn't continue. So we had to back off and come back here, and then we said, let's do some other movies. Let's do some smaller movies in between that, and it's great because we got together and started doing these other films, mm-hmm. and it'll be better because our team will be tighter and better after doing two or three other films, and then we'll go back there towards the end of the year.
Well, it seems like you are forming your little Hollywood team here and your new crew.
Yeah, coming along really good.
Definitely
working with a great group of people, and hopefully, you know, after that, go back and finish it. It would not have been right for him to finish doing that in the middle of something. Well, I have a lot of friends from there, so I that was a terrible thing that happened, and my heart goes out to everybody in the Philippines. I have a few questions, closing questions for you guys, just some fun stuff. First of all, how do you juggle a private investigation career, an acting career, both of you, and you as well, a writing career? How do you do it?
I don't know. I mean, how? I mean, really?
It's probably a bit easier for me. I mean, my availability of time, aside from investigations, I mean, I don't have that big a demand with investigative, with cases. I mean, I've been weaning myself off of it for the last year, doing more production and acting.
So you're retiring from the business?
I am. I want to, you know, by this time next year, I'd like to say that I don't need to do casework anymore. I'm doing what I'm really supposed to be doing, and it served its purpose for a long time, and it was what it was, and I'm proud of it. It's good.
So you're going to go on the James Bond Hall of Fame?
Yeah. Oh yeah. No, look, this is, you're looking at two different kind of PIs. I'm a PI, and he's an investigator. It's like pilots. There's pilots, and then there's aviators.
There you go.
I mean, there's a difference, but I admit it.
Well, if you had to do anything over again in your life, is there anything either of you would change?
I would have met him sooner.
Aww.
Agreed. I mean,
absolutely. Yeah, we're great together. We're a great team. You know.
All right, just don't start hugging.
And don't get any ideas. He's got a girlfriend. I got a girlfriend. You know,
thank you guys. I am so just happy to have you here, both of you. It's been such a pleasure. Thank you for joining me on Behind the Mask.
Thanks. It was a blast.
So great seeing you again. So great. And now I want to read you some homilies from my late great mentor and World War II veteran to whom this show is dedicated, Ivan Marcota. A friend is someone who, when you've made a fool of yourself, doesn't think you've done a permanent job. Most people are about as happy as they choose to be. Visions are worth fighting for. Why spend the rest of your life making someone else's? Join me next time on Behind the Mask when I bring you a very special artist whose work you may have seen if you've toured the White House. Check out my website at behindthemask.tv. Until then, this is Hollywood, over and out.